Hi everyone, Mr. Johnson here, and we are back with another episode of the Artist Gallery. Today we are talking about American artist Chuck Close. So if you are one of my students, make sure you have your sketchbooks, your artist images, scissors, glue stick, and a writing utensil so we can start cutting and pasting those Chuck Close images that you have into your sketchbook page, and we'll take down the notes that appear on the screen along with him. So I'm going to dive right in. Remember, if you're at home, you can always pause this video to, you know, get caught up as I jump right into Chuck Close. So Chuck Close, again, is an American contemporary artist. He is still alive and working right now. He was born on July 5th in 1940 in Monroe, Washington, in Washington State. He is best known for large-scale portrait paintings. Now, he went through a few different styles of art, from incredibly photorealistic to more abstract inspired, and we'll look at some examples of both of those as we go through our discussion on Chuck Close. But his paintings are humongous. As you can actually see in this first photo, this is a portrait by Chuck that we'll talk about in a little bit, but here he is standing next to it, so you can see the size of this artwork. Chuck Close has battled a lot of issues in his life. In 1988, he was paralyzed from a spinal artery collapse that left him in a wheelchair, in a spinal, a blood clot, you know, was in an artery in his spine. And all of a sudden now he was, you know, wheelchair bound and mostly paralyzed. He became a quadriplegic. So he wasn't, you know, for the first 48 years of his life, and then all of a sudden this happens. He still manages to paint after that. He creates contraptions that allow him to put a brush holding device that straps onto his wrist and forearm so that he can continue painting. So his, you know, his hands aren't, have the fine motor skills that he was used to, but he's able to attach, you know, a device to allow him to still paint. Not only does he have this, but he also, he's dyslexic. So, you know, when he looks at words, you know, and things, it changes up the order of the letters, it makes it difficult to read. He also has a condition known as face blindness. And we'll talk a little bit more about this in a moment. But that is a condition that prevents him from recognizing people's faces. So he might see someone, and then if you left the room and came back in, he wouldn't know if you were the same person or not. He's not able to recognize people's faces. He says often if you, you know, show him a photo of a friend or family member, he won't know who the person is. And it is a real condition, which is fascinating to look into, and we'll talk more about that in a little bit. In 1964, Chuck Close graduated from the Yale University School of Art with his master's degree in the fine arts. So that's really cool. He spent some time as a teacher. He traveled to Europe for a little bit. But we're going to dive in and look at some of his specific paintings. So again, this is the first one you should have if you are one of my students. This is called Big Self Portrait. Now, this was created in 1968. It is almost 9 feet tall by almost 7 feet wide. So this is, again, a very, very large painting. It's done with acrylic paint on canvas, and it was said that Chuck Close could thin the paint so much that he only had to use a few tablespoons of paint to create this entire portrait. He based his paintings off of photographs that he took himself, and because Chuck Close suffered from face blindness, which is called prosopagnosia. Right now, that's an SAT word, and it's right here up on the screen. His art focused on portraits because of this, and he thought that by flattening out the images on people's faces and painting them and studying them in such close detail that it would help him remember what people looked like. So most of the people he painted were friends and family members. This is obviously himself. But he thought that it would, you know, help him to remember what people looked like. He also did not use, you know, big facial expressions, crazy lighting. You know, his portraits were very straightforward. Also, again, you know, to help kind of analyze those facial elements. He was also really interested in recreating in paint what you could capture with the camera. So incredible fine details, right? Individual stubble hairs, things like that are included So the level of detail is amazing. When his portraits are, you know, printed in an art book, even at, you know, a really high quality, they're almost indistinguishable from photographs, which is pretty amazing. Yeah, full page reproductions in art books still look like, you know, a photo instead of a painting, but they are, you know, painted by hand, again, recreated from photographs that he took. So he wanted to just record the visual information. But one of the things that I think is really fascinating about his painting is how he's able to take elements that are in very clear focus, right? Like parts, you know, in the front of the face here, this part is very well focused. And then as you move back, the hair at the top and the neck and shoulders, those get a little bit fuzzier because they're more out of focus in the photo. I think that's just incredible. I mean, look at how amazing the painting is. But prosopagnosia is a real thing. So, you know, like something, you know, if you're in a restaurant and, you know, a waiter or waitress comes up to the table and they leave, he'd have no idea who his waiter or waitress was. Like, he would not be able to pick them out of a crowd or recognize them. Now, the opposite is also a real thing. You can have like super facial recognition, which means that you remember every face you've ever seen. And there are people that have that they'll say, oh yeah, that person was on the bus with me, you know, 20 years ago. And they'll remember, you know, people that they've seen forever. But it is a fascinating condition. Now, this is the next painting you have. This is called Emma from 2000, and it's 5 by 6 feet in size. Now, this shows the other style that Chuck Close is best known for. So this is done more recently, right? After he became paralyzed and was wheelchair bound, he changes up his style. So he uses now a grid to help recreate the photograph. So he would draw this grid over the photo and then put this grid on his large canvas. And what he would do is in each square of that grid, paint just abstract colors. So if you zoomed into this, right, each section just has some different shapes of pure color, so that each little square is an abstract painting, but when you step back from it, you see the full image. So it's such a cool style. It's still a very recognizable portrait, but it's done in a completely different way. So this is the other style that Chuck Close is really well known for. And again, these large paintings look just so impressive when you see them on a wall and they're, you know, the whole, you know, height of you is pretty amazing. So again, this is one that you don't have, but this is a photograph of Chuck Close in his wheelchair in front of a more recent self-portrait that he did in 2000. So, you know, not that long ago. And you can see in this new style how he's taken each square of that portrait and made it an abstract painting, just circles, ovals, you know, shapes of color, often multiple rings of colors. So it might be peach on the outside and then pink and then yellow and then green and then blue. And then from afar, though, it makes his face. So I do think that that's a really, really cool technique. Now, in 2010, Chuck Close appeared on The Colbert Report. It was interviewed by Stephen Colbert. It was a really great interview. So you know, you can check that out if you want to see more about him. So now let's hear a little bit more about Chuck Close from his own voice. I like hearing the artists be able to talk about their own work. So if this plays, which hopefully it does, there we go. We'll hear Chuck Close get to talk a little bit about his own work.
I started out wanting to be a magician, and I always broke the cardinal rule of magicianship, which was after I did a trick, I would show everybody how I did the trick, and that's supposed to ruin the illusion. But I always found it added to the illusion.
Chuck paints what he likes to call heads. He doesn't really necessarily think of his works as portraits in the 19th century attitude of what a portrait would be. In a way, it's almost about mapping the typography of a face.
From my earliest memories, I didn't recognize people or remember their faces. But I remember being in kindergarten, and by the end of the first year, I didn't know which kids were in my kindergarten class or the other one. So I knew that there was something going on, but it wasn't until much later that I really understood what I had wrong with me.
Chuck has a condition called face blindness, meaning that he does not recognize faces. That is one of the reasons that he uses photographs in his work instead of a sitter. Because if he's working with a person sitting in front of him, if that person turned their head just a little bit to the side like that, it would look to Chuck like a completely different image.
Behind me is the first portrait I painted in 1967-68, a 9-foot-high self-portrait that embodies many of the issues that I will continue for the next 30 years. I wanted to make a big, aggressive, confrontational image that was so large it could not easily be scanned as a whole and suck the viewer right up close to it. Everything I make is from photographs, and everything for 30 years has been built incrementally. A work like the one behind me appears to be seamless, but in fact it's built out of individual units. I break down the photograph into small bite-sized pieces that allow me to concentrate on one piece until I slowly build a whole. These are my friends and my family and my fellow artists, images that matter to me and that are the subjects of my paintings.
And you can see the size of this.
It's an automatic byproduct of what I do. I am most aware while I'm making something that I am not making a head. I'm aware of the artificiality of the situation, that it's paint on a pigment distributed across a flat surface. The fact that it ultimately stacks up to build an image which has any relation to reality is mystifying to me.
If I work from photographs, since it's already flat, I have a much better chance of remembering it. I have almost photographic memory for things that are flat. Since I don't recognize people, making portraits of people like I care about was a way to put their visage into my brain for good.
The idea of using a grid on a photograph and moving information from one square to another square, reinterpreting that information through the brush stroke, through the square of a print, allows him a sense of concentration and focus.
Well, really, all my work since 1967 has been done with a grid in one way or another. You know, it was something that was around since the dawn of time. The Egyptians scaled up things with a grid. It's a standard in the Renaissance as a way to enlarge things. But I started leaving the grid show, and that's sort of a different use of it.
In 1988, Chuck was at a speaking engagement and suddenly started to feel very ill. The last thing he really remembers is essentially crossing the street and walking into the hospital. When he woke up, he was, by all intents and purposes, a quadriplegic. As it happened, was diagnosed that his spinal artery had collapsed, something like an aneurysm in your spine. So the same kinds of tricks that he taught himself as a little boy to help him focus and learn, he brought then to the table one more time to recover to the point where he could go back to work.
It was essential. I had family, I had children, I had to figure out a way to get back to work. There just wasn't any question. The trouble was that I was paralyzed from here down, and they didn't know whether I was going to be able to move my arms, and I have no grip. I can't hold anything. But I thought, well, I'll get the paint on the canvas if I have to spit it on the canvas.
Once I get to the grid stage and I start laying them out, always one of them is more interesting than the other. I never wanted to project an image on a canvas. And the only way to get a drawing on that was in proportion to the original and accurate was to cut it off. In the early paintings, I would remove the grid as I made the painting. Around 1970, I began to do works in which the grid remained part of the piece itself. You know, it's funny because people think if you work from photographs that, first of all, everyone thinks it's cheating that you no longer have to look. But the other thing is you think once you accept a photograph, there's only one kind of picture to make from it. But all of these little subtle adjustments really make for a very different picture.
I like seeing this because it shows how he takes the, you know, the photo. It's obviously printed very high quality. They draw the grid over it. He's labeling it so that will help him create the large version, right, going just section by section. But then he is redrawing it up on the canvas, which is just pretty cool. So I think that's amazing. Now, here's another one that you don't have, but just another example of his photorealistic acrylic painting. This is a piece called Mark from 1979. I think this is just phenomenal. This piece is in the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. And even standing right in front of it, again, this, you know, it's huge. This is 15 feet tall by 7 feet wide. It's gigantic. And I've been there and seen this painting, and you stand right in front of it, and it looks like a printed photograph. The textures in it are absolutely incredible. And then this is the final one that you have. This is a piece called Fanny that was created in 1985, and I absolutely love this. It's 8.5 by 7 feet in size, and it is made from fingerprints. The entire painting are just fingerprints, dipping his thumb and his index finger in ink, and stacking them and layering them. And less ink makes the lighter areas, more ink makes the darker areas, but the entire piece is made solely from fingerprints. And look how incredibly realistic and detailed it is. I think it is absolutely incredible. But this is definitely a piece that you need to include in your sketchbook because it's just phenomenal. And right here, you can see Chuck Close working on it. This is in 1985. He is working on the painting. So he started at the top. He's going just, you know, section by section. He's got the photographs of Fanny right there for him to look at. And then he's just pressing his thumb on it to make those fingerprints. It's really, really amazing. That's an incredible amount of talent. And I just love all the different values and textures that Chuck Close was able to create using only fingerprints. So now for my students, there's a journal entry question that you should add in the text box. And that is, what obstacles, big or small, do you face in your life? How can these obstacles influence you? We talked about the things that Chuck Close faced, from the face blindness to, you know, the blood clot in his spine that caused him to be paralyzed. And so, you know, what obstacles, whether they're big or small ones, do you face in your life, and how can they influence you? So I'd love to know what you think. And then again, when you're finished with your artist page, take a photograph of it and post it to the assignment. If you like Chuck Close, please, you know, look at more of his artwork. He's absolutely incredible. So, you know, Google him and just take a look at all of the paintings he's done. They are really amazing.